Okay, we're going to continue with part two of chapter 14 in Lincoln. So this is just after they found Richmond was in ruins, still smoldering. Near the riverbank, a group of African American workers could be seen laboring in the broiling sun. They probably knew already that once the Union Army entered Richmond, they were legally free under the terms of the Emancipation Proclamation. But they surely never expected to see the proclamation's author up close. Once the workers realized who was approaching them, these former slaves rushed excitedly toward the president and began kissing his hand, crying and shouting with joy. "Bless the Lord," they yelled as they surrounded the visitor. "There is the great Messiah. Glory, hallelujah." One elderly man fell to his knees to thank the man he considered his deliverer. Now in tears himself, Lincoln urged him to rise. "Don't kneel to me. That is not right," he gently told him. "You must kneel to God only and thank him for the liberty you will hereafter enjoy." News of Lincoln's arrival spread rapidly. Even as the old gentleman rose to his feet, hundreds of African Americans began rushing to the scene, tumbling and shouting from over the hills and from the waterside, said one eyewitness, to see the man they believed to be their liberator and friend. When one black gentleman lifted his battered hat and tipped it to the president with a grand bow, Lincoln returned the gesture of respect. He doffed his own stovepipe topper, perhaps the first time an American president had ever tipped his hat to a black man. From behind their windows on the upper floors of the surrounding houses, white women looked in anger and disgust. As Lincoln later admitted, his enemies could easily have killed him that day. Abraham Lincoln was their savior, their Moses, remembered a reporter about the greeting Lincoln enjoyed from Richmond's African Americans that day. One elderly woman declared, "I know that I am free, for I have seen Father Abraham and felt him." Lincoln had met few actual slaves during his presidency. On this historic day, however, the president finally got to experience firsthand the human impact of what he had once described as a military order. The only report Lincoln allowed himself to send to Secretary of State Seward in Washington was a simple telegram. "I passed last night in Richmond and have just returned." In truth, he had passed that April 4th from a mere man to a genuine Messiah. Lincoln soon headed back to Washington. He was not with the army when Robert E. Lee surrendered to Ulysses S. Grant on April 9th. In fact, he was still aboard his steamer. But when he docked at sundown, he found Washington ablaze with bonfires, its church bells ringing in celebration. The war was finally over. The very next evening, a happy crowd massed outside the White House, filling the lawn and driveways. Musicians began serenading the president and calling for him to address them. Lincoln finally made a brief appearance from the usual upstairs window, admitted he felt greatly rejoiced that the people could not restrain their happiness. But he insisted he was not ready to make a formal speech. That would come, he promised, from the same spot the very next night. For now, he merely made a special request for a favorite old piece of music. "I have always thought Dixie one of the best tunes I have ever heard," he declared. "Our adversaries over the way attempted to appropriate it, but I insisted yesterday that we fairly captured it. I presented the question to the Attorney General, and he gave it as his legal opinion that it is our lawful prize. I now request the band to favor me with its performance." And to laughter and applause, the song that for 4 years had served as a Confederate national anthem was heard again at the White House. The following night, as promised, Lincoln reappeared in the second floor White House window to deliver his eagerly awaited answer to the question of what would come next. This time, another big audience was on hand to hear what the president planned to do to reunite the shattered and war-weary country. Lincoln did not offer a particularly eloquent speech that night. Though his mood remained good, he wanted to focus on future challenges, not past glory. But he started his speech by acknowledging the relief in so many northern hearts. "We meet this evening," he began, "not in sorrow, but in gladness of heart." He predicted a righteous and speedy peace whose joyous expression cannot be restrained. And then he turned his attention to the challenging business of the future. He would likely apply the Emancipation Proclamation to those areas in Louisiana and elsewhere that had been exempted from the original order 2 years earlier. He would oppose forced apprenticeships for freed slaves, but he also wanted Northerners to do all they could to restore Southern states to a proper, practical relation with the Union. To Lincoln, the Southern states were like lonely travelers who had spent too much time away and now longed to return to where they belonged. Finding themselves safely At home, he predicted, it would be utterly immaterial whether they had ever been abroad. Then Lincoln dropped a political bombshell. His first comments on the hot topic of civil rights for free African Americans. "It is also unsatisfactory to some," he began, "that the elective franchise is not given to the colored man. I myself would prefer that it were now conferred on the very intelligent and on those who serve in our cause as soldiers." To modern ears, these tentative words about black voting rights hardly sound generous. After all, Lincoln was suggesting that only educated black people and veterans of the army would be enfranchised, meaning able to vote. But to bigoted white people, even those cautious words seemed shocking almost beyond belief. For the first time, an American president was suggesting that black people were entitled to the right to vote. One of the shocked and angry whites in the crowd on the White House lawn that night was a famous young actor who had been murmuring a growing hatred for Lincoln. When the president spoke the words about giving African Americans voting rights, the actor turned to his friend Lewis Powell and fumed, "That means I can never support him. Now, by God, I will put him through. That will be the last speech he will ever make." The actor's name was John Wilkes Booth. For months, Booth and a gang of racist, pro-Confederate conspirators had plotted to kidnap Lincoln during one of his frequent carriage rides outside town. They planned to capture him and hold him for ransom until long-held Confederate prisoners of war could be freed in exchange. If thousands of captured rebel soldiers were returned south, Booth believed, Lee's army would again boast the manpower and energy to fight on. But Lee surrendered before Booth could bring his unlikely scheme to fruition. Now the war was over and Lincoln was proposing citizenship for black people, whom Booth despised. Kidnapping was now too good for the president, whom he considered a dictator. "The hour has come when I must change my plan," Booth concluded. Lincoln and other government leaders would have to be murdered. In the resulting turmoil, surely the South would rise again. 3 days later, on Good Friday, April 14th, the owner of Ford's Theater announced that the president would attend a special performance that night of the English comedy, Our American Cousin. Holy day or not, Lincoln felt that the best remedy for the long years of tragedy was laughter. At last, it was so in his case. He needed a little rest. When Booth learned of Lincoln's plan, he determined to kill him that very evening. The actor knew Ford's Theater extremely well. He had performed there and remained friendly with its owners and stagehands. No one would try to stop him if he entered the building during a performance. He knew the backstage layout so perfectly, he was sure he could make his escape untouched. He knew the place so well, he would be able to choose the precise scene, the exact line of dialogue during which to strike. He knew just when a huge burst of laughter would mask the sound of a gunshot. We'll stop there for today.